Yeah, just a minute. I've got the grill going right now. It's just about ready. Just give me this. Oh, I can't believe I did that.
Burns can be a complex injury because there's different degrees of a burn. There's also different sizes of a burn. We're going to take a quick look here at the different degrees by the way that you can see this bullseye shape as we go from the less of the degree to the most extreme. The pink outer ring is noting the first degree burn. It's noted with redness and pain. Then we move to the second degree, which is usually blistering, whether they are intact or they're popped. Blistering skin is a second degree burn. And then lastly, the dark charred area in the center of the burn, which is dry looking, could be split open, or a full thickness burn all the way to the bone. This is a third degree burn. This can be life-threatening, has a lot of complications, and is nothing to mess around with. I don't care what the size of it, it needs to be seen at the emergency care center appropriate for burns. Now, how do we treat these burns? Well, if I saw this, immediately we're calling 911 and getting emergency medical services on the way. But the sequence of treatments are as such. Remove the body from the burn. So if he was unconscious and lying in embers, we would remove that. If it was clothing that was still smoldering, we would remove the clothing safely. But remove the person from the burning agent. Secondly, cool the burn. Now, cooling of the burn means potable water, clean water. It doesn't need to be sterile. If it were sterile, that would be great. Cool to cold water is what we're looking for. And we're going to not touch the wound with the bottles, but we're going to basically just keep pouring water over the burn. We're going to do this for between 5 and 10 minutes, long enough to actually cool the full thickness of the tissue and stop the burning process. So let's say that we've cooled this burn now for up to 10 minutes. The tissue is cool. There was a lot of talk in years gone by about pre-antibiotic treated gauze or some petroleum-based gauze. Now the recommendation for the current standards is a loose, dry, sterile, if possible, dressing. I'm going to just lightly begin to wrap from above the burn where it started. I'm going to not put a lot of pressure. Again, in the third degree burn area, most of the nerves have already been damaged to the point where they're not actually sensing any pain, but the surrounding tissues of the first and second degree are going to be excruciating. So we want to keep that idea in our head as we're carefully handling the patient. We're going to watch this person to see if they're showing any signs of dizziness. If at any point they seem to be losing their balance, we want to make sure that we get them sitting or lying down in a position of comfort. So now after we've gone ahead and bandaged this burn, there are some significant points that we need to make. Number one is we need to make sure that we are watching this person for any signs of inhalation burns. Do they have any swelling or any kind of wheezing? Do they have burn marks on the facial hair, the eyebrows, the nose hair? If they open their mouth and we look inside, do they have any soot or granulated burn stuff inside their mouth? Which would suggest that when the flame exploded, they got scared and inhaled quickly and may have inhaled that superheated temperature of that air. So it's all important for us to keep those in mind because these symptoms might develop into a respiratory problem. And if that were to happen, we would simply move to treat them. If they become dizzy or lightheaded, we sit them down, lying them down. But keeping them in the position of comfort and keeping them out of shock is the most important thing while we wait for EMS to arrive. Now there's other forms of burns as well that we should be aware of, and that is chemical burns. If it was a dry chemical, it would be important to carefully, while keeping ourselves safe, brush off as much of the dry chemical first before we begin to rinse it off. And then rinsing off the remainder of the wet or dry chemical, we're going to do that for no less than 15 minutes. The solution to pollution is dilution. And that's a rhyme that we use so that we understand that even if it's not washing it off, it's diluting the chemical and weakening the chemical. So we just keep diluting that chemical down, helping stop the burn. If it is smoldering clothing, remember we're going to remove that without becoming a patient ourselves either. And then we're gonna monitor the patient and watch them until EMS arrives and until the next level of care can take over. So we've covered thermal burns, we've covered chemical burns, and the last one I wanna talk about is electrical burns. Before we ever come in contact with the patient, we need to understand that the energy source must be removed from the patient. That means de-energizing the source, getting the professionals out to cut the power to that line that's fallen down, whatever it is that needs to be done, but we cannot risk becoming a second patient by touching the primary patient and being electrocuted ourselves. Now, some significant differences in electrical burns compared to the other two. Electrical burns tend to have an entry point and an exit point. The entry point, though it can be small, could have that small bullseye of the first, second, and third degree burn. But the exit point could be explosive damage. That energy can literally show like a shotgun wound when it exits the ground of the body. And so on one end of the body, we might actually have soft tissue and bleeding control, while at the entry point, we have a burn to take care of. That burn will be managed the same way we described before, with the removing of the burn source, the cooling, and the dressing. Now, some other things to think about, though, is the fact that if that electric power was so much that it exploded as it exited, it might also have fractured long bones. So that's something to keep in mind. And then lastly, remember that the electricity as it travels through the body could also affect the conductivity of the heart and damage those conduction points in the heart. And in the next 24 to 72 hours, we can sometimes see the development of life-threatening dysrhythmias develop as this person is pretty relatively stable from the burn or the wounds themselves, but then develops cardiac issues secondary to the electrocution. All these things should be kept in mind as we're treating these different burn patients and keeping ourselves safe in the meantime as we wait for EMS to arrive and take the patient to the next level of care.